Hello, this is the third of these videos we're putting together as an advanced workshop on systematic quantitative literature reviews, which complements the existing original four videos. And in these, we're going through some additional information about each of the stages. And this, the third one, is going to be looking at advanced data analysis. And that relates to step 11, evaluating the key results and drafting the results section of your paper. Now remember, this is part of this online support material where there's more details there about the method overall, the other videos, example databases, the increasing list of papers publishing the method, and of course the original paper outlining the method with those 15 steps. And if you do end up publishing your literature review, please think about citing us. We're really keen for that, partly to get some credit, partly to be able to share the experience and then be able to look at and advance the methods. And what we're talking about today is partly from using that increasing body of literature that you used the method and cited us to show you some advances on the way you can do this particular method. And that comes to that in the original paper and some of the original examples, we had these basic analysis. So if people have coded their data using ones and blanks in an Excel or a database like that, they can then very rapidly generate these sorts of tables. And in many cases, these tables, although relatively simple, have identified some really important gaps in the literature. And some, remember, one of the key things about the systematic quantitative literature is that maps where there is literature, but also where there are gaps. And that often is the most important result in the reviews, is identifying key gaps and how that's shaping the literature. Narrative literature that reviews concentrate on what's known. Meta-analysis may, by systematically searching for the literature, find us about unknown knowns. But this method is really powerful because it tells us about unknown unknowns, gaps in the literature we may not have been aware of that are often really important. So here's a really simple one. We're just reporting about what countries the research comes from. And as you can see here, what it's highlighting is that in terms of the study location, quite a lot of the research was just done in the United States, Canada, Australia, and the United Kingdom, but there is very little research from lots of other places in the world. They've also recorded it by the author's affiliation. So where did they come? Where were the authors based? And again, that reinforces that dominance of the United States, Canada, and Australia, and the United Kingdom, with very few studies from other countries. So again, that's a really important result and an important gap in the literature, because therefore it's saying that literature is very heavily influenced by the political social context of those countries. The other one's done the same thing, recording number of studies and the percentages, but here what they're looking at is some of the methods used. And again, you can see that relatively simple things, was it molecular ecology, taxonomy, structured variables, review, ecosystem function, etc., is highlighting really strong patterns that most of the literature on this topic is actually descriptive. In some cases, you can even be using these for key concepts. So this is one where they've looked at the key concepts and constructs and looked at the frequencies that those have been recorded in the papers. Another one has done it about thematic field and subclusters. And in that case, there's a relatively small literature. They're actually showing you explicitly which studies have looked at which frameworks, method integration, which were case studies, which used alternative assessment methods. Then you can do this basic analysis, similar data, but presenting it in graphs. And a really classic one to do is to look at the time sequence of the research. And you can see this one here on the left is looking at over time, there's been a dramatic increase in the topic, but they've broken it down into four time periods to show that thing about exactly how much literature there is. The top one is showing you just those countries, but doing it as a bar graph to show that thing about that dominance of certain locations, and it's both showing you countries and continents simultaneously. So the colour is the continent, and the bar is for each country. And the bottom one, again, is showing you number of publications by year, but this is a literature that has a very short timeline where it's only basically started about 2013, but in 2015 there are over 121 papers on the topic. This is a really interesting one where it's summarising lots of results, but what it's done is it standardised each of these categories, so it's presenting them as a proportion out of 100. So what journals by category? As you can see, it's mostly this literature is about veterinary science, microbiology, a little by immunology, and then a lot of others. It's also talking by category. Then it's publication decade, again showing you the dominance of certain periods. But what's really interesting in this topic is that there was some research in the 1980s, there was more in the 1990s, then there were actually few in the 2000s, but a huge increase more recently. So you can see how they've looked at them, quantitative and qualitative methods, qualitative only, what was the focus of the study, and then what was the major focus and the minor. Really simple way of expressing it, but very powerful to show you patterns in the literature. In the previous video, I talked about coding by discipline areas of the journal. And because this study did that, they were then able to show this sort of diagrams with some simple pie charts to show the breakdown of which were the subject areas that were really important. So as you can see for this topic, a large proportion of the literature was in engineering and computer science. With the other, it's broken down into a whole lot of different topics and discipline areas. Then they've broken down within engineering, what aspects of engineering were the disciplines related to, the journals they were publishing in, and the same for the computer science. Another thing is really basic analysis is to look at is maps, and these are some different combinations of them, where they've done some fairly simple ones by using colour coding intensity by countries, and that sort of graph is really easy to do and can even be done in Excel. The others have used more advanced ones where they're more specific in the location, so they've often maybe recorded in detail the geographical location of the study, not just the country, etc. And the size of the dots indicates the number of studies, so you can see a really strong patterning in the data. Now, all of those are basically still just one variable. Moderate analysis is one variable against another, where you do the numbers or percentage of studies in tables. And this is, in a sense, sometimes you might already, when you start the review, think that you might want to be comparing one thing to another. But often you might, when you get the data, you start to get to feel for where the studies are, what are the factors important, and you get these emergent results. So this one was looking at the benefits obtained by transformative travellers versus the type of travellers that they were, or the type of travel they did, I should say. And you can see how it again is showing you some really interesting patterns around it, but by coding across the variables as separate columns, they can really easily generate this sort of table using pivot tables in Excel. In some cases, you can then combine that using statistics, really simple ones here, chi-square, where you're saying this was for conference topics, themes and conferences, abstracts. What it was saying is have the proportion of those topics varied amongst the conferences. So you can see up the top that the number of abstracts per conference varied. That's been corrected for with the Excel, with around the observed versus the expected. And then it's saying, okay, were there some years that certain topics like perceptions more common than you'd expect on average across all of the number of abstracts, how often the 32% of all of the abstracts were about perceptions. In some years, was there a higher or lower percentage than that? So that's another way that you can power add to it. Have to follow the rules of the chi-squared, fairly easy to do, have a look at those. You can also do things where you're showing overlaps. And this is going back to that classic Venn diagram that we talk about in the beginning, where you've got these three overlapping topics, and they're saying how many of them is in the centre of that topic. And as you can see, in both cases, there isn't actually, particularly in the top case, there's only 1% of the papers are overlapping economic, social and ecological. And there being more of the papers were focused around some of the other aspects. The diagram below, same type of thing, showing you what's the percentage in each of those broad disciplines, and the overlap between two disciplines and the overlap of all three. The bottom one is a really simple spider diagram, again really easy to do in Excel, and it's a really neat way of mapping where there is literature but where there are gaps. So the dark area is showing you the space occupied by the research, and you can see on those diagrams some obvious and important gaps that are shown. So there's not much about political institutions, politics and institution in this type of study. This is a lovely one too, using colour and some really simple things to show a quite important concept, which is that how a discipline matures, it starts to diversify. So this was looking at particular methods to look at coral, and what you can see is that in the early papers, nearly all of the studies in purple are descriptive. But as the literature has matured to the most recent literature, you can see that there is a whole lot of different types of approaches looked. So there's studies looking at anthropogenic impacts. There are ones that ecosystem function, life history, management methods, molecular ecology, natural impacts, reviews, etc. So you can see how this is showing the discipline is maturing. Same thing for the bottom diagram, where it's looking at the different methods used to study the coral. And what you can see is that obviously scuba is the most important, but you can see that in the early studies, there was basically nearly all of the studies were using scuba or a few using submersibles. But more recently, in the last few years, the deep purple, you can see that there's a huge diversity of methodology used to have a look. So what people are looking at is different and how they're looking at it as the disciplines matured. Here's a really simple graph. It takes really easy default style used in Excel. And this is looking at conference abstracts, and it's looking at, again, those themes over time. And it's a really neat way to display that sort of table, but much more interactively. But again, these are still one variable against another. The third level of analysis is where you do multidimensional analysis methods. And there are a range of these available. This is one that's used multivariable categorical principal component analysis of the abstracts from these conferences to look at where there were clusters of topics. So what it's showing you is that amongst them, there was a cluster of abstracts that looked at visitor profile, motivation, satisfaction, and experience. And they were a little bit more likely to come from papers published from North America and Asia. And then there was another cluster, which was behavior, perceptions, and attitudes. Same sort of multidimensional analysis results can be presented as a cluster. And this is a really interesting one because this is an analysis of a qualitative literature. It's about a German philosopher called Carl Schmitt. And in this case, they've coded all these papers that looked at Carl Schmitt. And when they coded it, they said, which other philosophers were also talked about in the same paper? And from the bottom, what it's showing you is a huge number of different other philosophers were discussed. And you can see some real classics in here, Plato, Aristotle, etc., more recent ones, etc., Marx. But what you can see is that on the side, it's showing you the percentage similarity. And it's showing you that there are very few papers that talk about Schmitt and more than one other philosopher together in a consistent way, where it's always both the same other philosophers. And so what that's showing is that although people are relating to Schmitt to a whole lot of other philosophers, there's not a lot of coherence amongst the literature in which other philosophers they're discussing. Here's another one where there's more structure in it. So it's the same type of analysis, but here it's saying that the results show you there were really strong clusters based on the concept. So group one were conceptual focus, group two, group three, group four, etc. It's showing you there was quite strong grouping amongst the methods. So this is saying that the data had a lot of structure in it and what that structure was. And of course, you can go beyond the systematic quantitative literature review to also include other methods. So for example, here's a paper that not only quantified the literature, but it also mapped the themes using Leximancer. And so what it did is using programming within that package, extracted and ranked a list of keywords and phrases from the source text, and then used that intelligent algorithm to iteratively build up this thesaurus of concepts for more than one or two keywords, and then indexed and weighted it and explained it as this diagram. And that's also, again, really important to see how the concepts relate to each other. And that's what all three of these types of, or these examples of these multidimensional analysis is doing. And another example is using programs, free online programs such as VosViewer, and that again is showing you the relationship, in this case, amongst keywords and concepts. So you can see it's a heat map where the redder the points are, the more likely those concepts or keywords were to be occurring in the same paper. What's the diversity of topics looked at, and what are the concentrated ones? What else? You guys are amazing. You're developing all these new methods. We're really excited. So we'll keep updating this as we find out about new methods that people are using. And hopefully soon this will be you. And remember, go check out the last paper. That's where we go through where some of the issues that reviewers might pick up on that you can deal with originally in your paper. So So check that one out.